be with us, I invite you, if you're able, to stand as we sing, "This Is the Day." This is the day, this is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice, we will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made, we will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made.
Oh, In Psalm 18, we have these words, beginning with verse 1, which says, I love you, Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, my deliverer. My God is my rock, in whom I take refuge, my shield, and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call to the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and I have been saved from my enemies. And then later on in Psalm 18, we have these words in verse 46. If I can get my page to... All right, there we go. The Lord lives. Praise be to my rock, exalted to be God my Savior. We see in the Bible throughout a theme of God being the rock. That means that he is our strength. It means he is our refuge, as people would hide in the rocks against enemies. And also, he is our security. We're going to see a little bit later on in the Bible, Jesus talking about he being the rock of our lives, our Savior.
Everyone needs compassion.
Savior, we can do promise.
working in everything. When things are wonderful, we should praise his name. When things are terrible, we should praise his name. Because in all things, blessed is holy, holy name.
Yeah.
Jesus is the cornerstone. Came for sinners to atone. Though rejected by his own, he became the cornerstone. Jesus is the cornerstone. When I am on this stone, I am at rest. When the seeds of truth are sown, he remains the cornerstone. Jesus is the
kid, and even now, I've always been amazed at God's creation, the whole natural world. I loved watching National Geographic specials growing up about the wonders of our world. But you know, of all the National Geographic specials I ever watched, I never saw one special on the wonderful world of rocks. Rocks. Something you probably don't think about a whole lot. When was the last time you just meditated on God's creation of the rock? But there's a lot about rocks that's very interesting. For example, how many of you know what the softest rock in the world is? The softest one. Anybody know? That's what I would have thought. No, it's a rock called talc. Now you may go, I've never heard about talc, but you have. Because talcum powder is made out of talc and cornstarch. And most of us experienced talcum powder when we were younger. We were getting our backsides literally sprinkled with it when our diapers were changed. What's the largest rock in the world? Well, it's a place called Mount Augustus in Australia, where as you drive through the Australian outback, suddenly this huge mountain formation comes ahead of you that's 5 miles long, almost 2 miles wide, and almost a half a mile high. And it's one solid rock. The smallest rocks are something you've experienced, maybe thought about. Soil. You realize soil is made up of organic material, but the non-organic material is microscopic rocks that have disintegrated over time. So you've had in your hands the smallest rocks ever made. What's the hardest rock? Anybody know what the hardest rock is? What's that?
Obsidian.
Good answer, but no, that's not it. I thought it was granite. That's not it. It's diamonds. Diamond, technically, is a rock.
Wow.
I didn't know that. But you know, even though the diamond is the hardest rock, the diamond's not the strongest rock. The strongest rock is Jesus Christ. Let's take a look at Matthew chapter 7 as we study the last sections of the Sermon on the Mount. So turn with me, if you will, to Matthew chapter 7. I'm turning as you turn. It says in verse 24 of chapter 7, as Jesus begins to wind up this great series of topics on the Sermon on the Mount, it says, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who has built his house on the rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against that house, yet it did not fall because it had its foundations on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine but does not put them into practice is like a foolish man who builds his house on sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against the house, and it fell with a great crash." We see here Jesus referring to himself as the rock. Now, we saw in the book of Psalms that God is referred to as a rock. Well, Jesus, being the Son of God, God himself, is a rock as well. Back in October 10th, 2018, a huge hurricane blew into Mexico Beach, Florida, called Hurricane Michael. Probably don't remember it now with everything else that's happened. It's one of the most powerful hurricanes ever recorded, a Category 4. And after it had gone through Florida and parts of the South, between $8 and $11 billion of damage was caused. 50 people died. 200,000 at one point was without power. As helicopters flew over the damaged area, we could see whole swaths of houses and buildings gone. But occasionally, you'd see a building still standing. Thousands of buildings around it were gone, but one stood. The reason was it was built out of superior materials, but more importantly, its foundations, or the piles it was built on, had been piled down into the bedrock. To do so in Florida requires a lot more money, a lot more effort, and most people don't go to the trouble to build on a foundation of the bedrock. But those that did survived when hundreds of thousands of other people did not. Jesus is letting us know that spiritually we need to also build on the rock. That bedrock being Jesus himself. Now the word for rock here, Petron, comes from the word Petra, which means foundation rock, bedrock. Not a little stone, but that which is unshakable. He says here that, "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine..." So we see, first of all, we need to hear Christ's words. This is more than just hearing the words, but actually knowing them, listening to what God has to say. We live in a world where we often don't listen to one another. We live in a world where people can be in a congregation like today, hear everything that's said, but it doesn't really register. So when Jesus says here, "Hear me," he's saying, "Listen to what I have to say and remember." We hear Christ's messages too often, forget. I've told you the story about the man who came to me up on a Wednesday night and said, "Wow, Sunday was a powerful message." I said, "Well, that's great. What part of it really touched your heart?" He said, "Well, I don't remember what it was about. I just remember it was powerful." And too often, that's the way we listen to Christ speaking to us through teaching or the preaching. Our mind is in a million different directions. We have a lot of things going on. Maybe today, right now, you're wondering what you're going to eat when you get off. I don't know if there's a NASCAR race today, but maybe NASCAR is on your mind. Whatever it might be. But the bottom line is, too often, we really don't hear what God has to say. We may even listen to the sermon. Well, we don't hear about what God has to say to us personally, the application that he wants us to do in our own lives. We must not only know the words, but we need to hear them. And it goes on to say that it's not enough just to hear. It says, "Everyone who hears these..." words of mine and puts them into practice. The word there from the Greek is to do. We're to do what Jesus tells us to do. Hearing is not enough. Knowing is not enough. We need to live Christ's words. But the problem is this. We hear, we know, but we don't live what God has to say to us. What I want you to do right now as we hear this message is hear what God wants you to do on Monday based on what you heard on Sunday. And on Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday. Are you going to apply what God is saying right here in His written word in your lives? Here's the problem. For many of us, if we really are honest and evaluate our life, we will have to admit that our spiritual life hasn't changed that much compared to 2 or 4 years ago. We've not made a lot of forward progress in living the words of Jesus Christ. We're about to finish a series I've been doing off and on for a couple of years now. Some of the most powerful teachings of Jesus. And much of what we've heard, we've not really allowed it to transform our lives. For example, we talked just a couple weeks ago about judging one another, what that means and what it doesn't mean. Have you changed in your life, or are you working on change based on judging one another incorrectly? My guess is, for many of us, we hear, we know, but we don't live. We know it, but we don't live it. But it goes on to say that when we hear and we do, we put them into practice, it's like building on this rock. Now we know earlier in Matthew chapter 18, that Jesus said, upon this rock I will build my church. And when we build on the bedrock of Jesus Christ, what He teaches, the way He lived, we will have a church that will be stable at all times. But what's sad is so often, and too many churches, we're affected by the world. The world on the outside and the world on the inside through us. And we see churches come and go through conflicts and splits and be ineffective and neutralized. Why? Because we've not built on the rock of Jesus Christ. We talk about Jesus, but we're not living Jesus in our life as a church or as individuals too often. And Jesus is giving us a warning here. Hear, know, and live that which I have taught. And then you will be built on the rock, which is Christ Himself. A rock provides strength, stability, and security in an uncertain, chaotic, and stormy world. Boy, we know about storms, don't we? We've just experienced the worst winter storm that Houston has experienced in many years. 8 inches or more of snow. Temperatures dropping down to 10 below zero. You know it's bad when it hits 8 or 9 degrees and you think you're getting a heat wave. That's what happened this week. We know what storms are all about. But by building on Christ as our work, as our rock, we connect to God, His blessings, His guidance, His power, and His protection. But when you find your life being swayed back and forth by the various storms of life, you got to ask yourself, am I built sufficiently on the rock? You see, we've been called to be builders spiritually in our world. And by the way, the house we're talking about is just not our own life. The house we're talking about is our life, the life of our family, those that we influence, and those around us. Too often our life, our house, is not greatly affected by what we say we believe about Jesus. Instead, our house is built on sinking sand, which we're going to look at in a minute. It goes on to say in Matthew 7:25, the rain came down, the streams rose, the winds blew and beat against the house, yet it did not fail. Because it had its foundation on the rock. What's sad is for so many people, including some of us here, we look back on our life, or maybe even what's going on presently, and we see spiritual failure happening too often. You know of friends who have dropped out of the Christian life, dropped out of church. Maybe you yourself, for a period of time, dropped out before you came back. Why? Because there was a point when the storms blew in your life, It might be the storms of loss of a loved one, or financial struggle, or personal struggle, career struggles of various kinds. And when those storms blew, you found your house being swayed back and forth, maybe even taken off its foundation. But when we build on the rock, and we build deep on the rock of Jesus Christ, we will withstand the storms. We will experience God's blessings, guidance, protection, and strength during those tough times. The fact is simply this: Jesus is the ultimate spiritual weather forecaster. He said storms are going to happen. He didn't say if storms happen. He said storms are going to happen in our life. Being a Christian is not a guarantee that you're stormproof. It's not going to happen to you. But when we live Jesus as our rock, we can be stormproof through the storms of life. Those storms might be stress, disease, disappointment, rejection, injustice, death, loneliness, doubts, accidents, loss, sorrow, suffering, and so much more. Some of you experienced a lot of storms this year. Others throughout our country experience even more than we have. But those who are built on the rock will weather the storms. These storms threaten to destroy your house, your life, and your family. You may be physically alive, but spiritually, your life is wrecked. You have no hope, little faith. They're lost. But believing in Jesus, keeping your eyes on Him, and building deep in knowing and living His words guarantees that you will survive. You may be damaged, but you will not be blown away. Well, how do we build on that house? Well, we build on the rock, not on the shifting sand. Take a look at Matthew 7:26. It says, "But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like the foolish man who built his house on the sand." That's kind of silly, isn't it? How many of you would build a house on sand? No. Now, there's a lot of areas down south, like in Florida and Georgia, where you have very sandy land. But even then, they try to find the places where it isn't too sandy. Why? Because they know they'll sink, and they can be blown away if their house is built on sand. As a matter of fact, those houses along the beaches when the hurricanes hit, we talked earlier about those who had their pilings deep, 30, 40, sometimes 50 feet into the bedrock, their houses will survive. But most did not. Why? Because they weren't built in the bedrock. They were basically built on the sand, and they did not survive. If you ignore Jesus and His words, you may hear, but choose not to remember, or you may remember, but choose not to live it, then you're effectively rejecting the Christ that you say you believe in. Too many of us today are living lives of practical atheism. We say we believe in Jesus. We say we know Jesus. But our life is lived with other priorities, other belief systems. We're not living Jesus in our life. We're practical atheists. If you listen on Sunday and say, "Oh, I believe," but you go out on Monday and live your life other ways, you're a practical atheist. Are you a practical atheist? Too many of us are a little bit like the husband who said he loved his wife, but he continued to cheat on her over and over and over and over again. And when she finally said, "I'm going to leave you," he goes, "But I love you." She said, "No, you don't, because you prove your love by the way you live." Are you a practical atheist? If we ignore Jesus and His words, or hear what Jesus has to say, but don't practice them, we have our house on sand. It is your house, you, your belief system, and that of your family, based on Jesus. It always breaks my heart when I hear someone say, "Well, I don't make my kid come to church because I will let him choose what he wants to believe." And I'm thinking, what third grader is going to jump out of bed and go, "I want to go to church on Sunday"? A few will, many won't.
Yeah,
and I always ask those people, "Do you give your child the option to go to school or not? Do you give your child the option of what they get to eat?" Now, I can tell you right now, as a kid, if I had my choice in eating, it'd be candy and Twinkies. Okay? Not broccoli or spinach or all the good stuff. It wasn't good to me, but it was good for me. Is your house built on the rock? Or is it built on the shifting sands of deism, materialism, humanism, Eastern religious philosophies, hedonism, careerism? Sometimes we can build our house even on that which we call Christian religion, but the religion is not Jesus-focused. If your religion is legalistic, it's based on the law, it's based on not thinking about a relationship with Jesus Christ, but just doing the church stuff, you're not built on the rock. Oh, I know, that's kind of shocking, isn't it?
Yeah.
You can do church and not do Jesus, folks. And sometimes you can even do Jesus and not do church, but he wants you to do church as well as him at the same time. It says in Matthew 7:27 these words, the rain came down. Notice it said rain would come down. The streams rose and the winds blew and beat against the house. And then that house built on the sands fell with a great crash. Have you met people like that? They fell with a great crash spiritually. Their life was a wreck. At one time they called themselves Christians. They went to church. But when the tough times came and the storms blew, it came down with a great crash. Your house may seem safe and secure during the smooth times of good spiritual weather, but is it ready to handle the stormy times? Those shifting sands of unchristian priorities, philosophies, and beliefs may seem to work for you right now, but when the storms come, they will fail you. Today we live in a world and a culture that more and more is pushing non-Christian belief systems and lifestyles as the way to live and to go. And we're going to live in a world where when storms come, there'll be so many houses destroyed in the process. That's already happening, isn't it? Take a look. We're seeing rising crime. We see broken families everywhere. Suicide has skyrocketed over the last year because of the storm of COVID-19. Yep. And we found that too many people did not have their house built on the rock. And so when it got tough, they decided to check out through suicide. Today, more than ever before, it's time for us to reevaluate to be sure that our house is built on the rock. Because the storms will come, they will hit. Very few people expected the pandemic that happened. Those who were experts forecasted that eventually we would have a pandemic. Matter of fact, there was a film that came out several years ago called Contagion, starring Matt Damon and Gwyneth Paltrow, that when you watch it today, you're going, wow, it's like they could see into the future. If you haven't had a chance, watch that film, because you're going to see the coronavirus. It's not called that there, but basically everything that we have experienced was forecasted in that film because the experts wrote it. But how many of us really were expecting a pandemic? How many of you woke up going, a pandemic's coming? Yep, I know it's coming. Storms are going to come, folks. Jesus has forecasted that. Are you going to be ready? The Katrinas, the Hurricane Michaels, the pandemic, COVID-19s are going to come, and it's not the end with this one. There'll be other storms of various types to come. Will you be ready by building on the rock? If not, your house will come down with a big crash. The ultimate crash is not in this life, but when you stand before God in judgment. Jesus is very clear. There'll be those who say, Lord, Lord, I did all these things for you. And he said, away from me. I never knew you. Just because you can say the word Jesus doesn't mean you live Jesus in your life. Have you built your house on the rock? Are you ready? At this time, we're going to have a song of response. We need to be honest. Are we built on the rock? Maybe you're built only partially on the rock. Because you know what? Building on the rock's harder work than building on the sand. Building your house out of quality Jesus materials, it's harder work than building it out of the world's materials. Is your house built on the rock? Let's Let's all stand as God speaks to us today.